Hi and welcome everybody. I'm giving this talk in English because I wanted to have an English recording of this talk. I gave more or less the same talk. Of course, this one is improved a bit at the GPN this year. So if you want to listen also to the German version, you can look it up, but I'll give this in English. So the title is Testing Software, Yes Please. My name is Daniel Kulesch, and yeah, first a few words about me. So yeah, I'm doing some professional activities like working in the DevOps field, and I'm also a researcher and PhD student, and I'm also a lecturer. And of course, in the free software space, I'm also yeah, quite active. I'm not very constructive most of the time, so often I just submit bugs about things that annoy me. And I also support many people who are trying to use free software with many basic things, but also more advanced stuff. I'm also a supporter of the FSFE, and I'm an initiator of this project system test portal, which will be part of this talk. And also the spreadsheet inspection framework, that is a scientific project. Well, yeah, that's about me, but of course I would also be interested about you guys here in the audience. So I draw here a few nice squares, and the question is, think about to which of this group you would feel most addicted to, and I will just ask how many people of which group we have. So who would say he or she is more in the developer category? Ah, so many developers interested in testing, interesting. Managers? Nope. Administrators? Okay, one. Penetration testers? Two? Ah, four, one. End users? Yeah, I was expecting that. And others? Okay, one other. Fine. Yeah, and well, the good thing is that I'm trying to address all of these groups in the audience, so I hope there will be something for everybody here. Yeah, so quick agenda over my talk. So first of all, I'd like to motivate the topic, and I'd like to introduce the idea of community-supported manual testing. Maybe sounds a bit scary, but we'll get into that. And after that, I'd like to give a quick demo about our tool, the System Test Portal, which was built to help with that. And after that, I'll talk a bit about the project behind that, so the open source project from which this software originated. And in the end, I'll give a quick summary, and hopefully we'll have some time for Q&A. Yeah, so let's start with the motivation. Yeah, well, why testing? I hope I don't have to explain this too much in depth. Well, of course, even if we are in the open source world, I hope we want to avoid this typical tinkerer image that probably many people have, or the Frickelware image in German, right? So we want to build software that works, and not software that the first thing after you start it is you think about submitting a bug report. And if we do new releases of our software, of course, we want to make sure that it still works. Yeah, and if we are maybe in the commercial space, we also want to avoid any penalties for delivering software that does not work, right? So this is why we do testing. We don't do testing to prove that our software works correctly, yeah, because as we all know, by testing, you can't prove that software does not contain any bugs. You can only show that software contains bugs. Yeah, that's the old rule, but by Edgar Dijkstra. So yeah, I would say that a quite good way to do testing is by doing test automation. Who thinks that test automation is great? Yeah, most people, yeah. Sure, I was expecting that. Well, but there is a bad part about that. Yeah, so test automation is great. I really agree with that. But there are certain issues with test automation. So first of all, when you try automating your tests, you often deal with complex tool landscapes. Yeah, so you have to some complicated framework for testing. You have to get into that. You have to manage your testing framework. Then there is some update of the testing framework. Now you need to, I don't know, adapt your tests or whatever. Can be quite complex. And you also have, let's say, stupid test oracles. So if I do testing with humans, and now I'm seeing a certain behavior, and I think, hey, what's that? That's pretty strange. What's happening here? Yeah, then I notice that, and I maybe will say, okay, this is failing somehow. If I do an automated test, the testing oracle which I programmed or configured can only look at the things which I expected beforehand, right? So for instance, if I'm testing a, I don't know, mobile device, and I test the app drawer, and I check if scrolling in the app drawer works, right? So maybe I can do an automated test, like scroll down and click on the bottommost icon and see if the application opens. Perfect. But what I probably won't find by doing automated testing is to see when I scroll if, I don't know, the status bar flickers, if I didn't think about that beforehand. Yeah, or I will not find that when I'm in the app drawer and I'm scroll, then the device starts vibrating for whatever reason. I won't find that because I was not expecting that when I was designing the test case. Right? So usually humans are better testing oracles, maybe not the cheapest one, but better. And another thing is that depending on what you actually test, there are also some things that make it limited for automation. So for instance, if you test firmware, if you test embedded systems, right, this is an area that is not that easy to automate. Of course, you can build a nice, I don't know, hill stand, for instance, for automating. But if you're a small free open source developer, you probably don't have the money to do that, right? So you have to somehow do manual testing. Yeah, and this is also an example here with free firmware. So I guess most of you guys are already running some free software on the operating system level or on the application level. Yeah, but if you want to really liberate yourself, that doesn't really help much if you are using non-free, proprietary, closed source firmware, for instance, for your, I don't know, Wi-Fi firmware, for your Bluetooth firmware, for things like UEFI BIOS. I'm using Coreboot on this laptop, which is pretty good. But of course, it doesn't run on all machines, and newer machines need firmware and so on. Yeah. But the good news is, yeah, that there are several projects that try to produce free Libre firmware, or at least free firmware that needs some non-free parts, but at least they liberate most things. So who has heard of Postmarket OS? Nobody. It's an Alpine-based distribution for mobile phones. Quite nice. Or Replicant. Yeah, okay. Or UB ports. I hope some did, because they had a stand here, right? I dropped by there. Yeah, Lineage OS. I guess most of you know that. Yeah, and all those things. We have similar stuff for classic computers like, yeah, Coreboot, Libreboot, Linux Boot, OpenBMC. So if you're in the server business and you need to remotely manage them and you don't want to run the very trustworthy vendor firmware, you can try OpenBMC. For routers, I guess almost everybody here will know OpenWRT, right? Yeah, so there's also LibreCMC, which is like a variant of OpenWRT that doesn't use any binary blobs but supports much fewer devices. We have OpenHAB, they had a stand here, which probably most of you noticed, and Sonoff Tasmota, if you want to, I don't know, have any power sockets that you want to drive in your IoT network. And there are many of these smaller scale things like Gadget Bridge. So if you use a smartwatch like I do, But you don't want to have one that sends all your data to the vendor's cloud, especially health data. Then you can use Gadget Bridge, so your data will stay on your phone, basically, or OpenScale, who knows that? So if you need a have a scale for, you know, things like body mass index that's computed with your weight, of course, and body fat and stuff like that. So there are many of those devices out there. And luckily, there is OpenScale that is a free app that works with some scales. You can buy one for, I don't know, 20 euros or something. And yeah, this is an app you probably also want to test, right? And all these projects, they produce some kind of software that we want to test. And now the question is how to do that. Yeah, and the problem here is that if you have such devices, you can only get a certain validity of your tests if you run them on the real hardware. Yeah, so if you test a scale, yeah, you can try to automate the test of your software somehow, but in the end, it's the question if you step on the scale and the Bluetooth communication will work, so the measures from the scale will get transferred to your device. Yeah, and there are many projects. I think OpenWRT is a pretty good example of that, that support really tons of hardware. They support, like, I don't know, more than 1,000 different routers. Yeah, but you see, I have put support here in Mark. So they do support that. They say that. And they provide many, many releases every year for all the devices they support. But maybe you will find, like I did with OpenWRT, you take a certain device that was once working, and you see, oh yeah, great, it's supported by OpenWRT. So you take the latest stable release for this device, you flash it, and it doesn't boot. Well, why? Well, there were some changes. Nobody tested them. It's supported, but it's broken. And that's, of course, something we want to avoid. Yeah, so often these tests that are done on these devices, they are not done systematically. Often they are not done at all. There are devices which used to work, which now became broken. And for the end users, this can be pretty frustrating, especially if I'm trying to convince people to run free software and to buy these devices that are greatly supported by LineageOS or OpenWRT or whatnot. And then they buy this device and they find that it's not working. Yeah, that's yeah, pretty frustrating for the end users, and I think we need to deal with that somehow. And another example, which is just, I was at the FOSS Asia stand today and got this nice blinky thing here. And they also have an app with which you can drive that. So you can change, I don't know, the speed, how this thing goes here, or the of course, the text, you can put some images in there and so on. And if you now want to test this app, of course, what will you need? Well, you will need this device. You can put it in some upload mode. Then you make some inputs in your application that's running on your phone that you can see the screenshots from here. And then you upload this new data to this device and you check if it really does what you configured in the app. And to do that automatically, I don't know, you could put this somewhere and do some image recognition to see if it works maybe, but I think we all agree that it's not so easy to automate this kind of test, especially if you have a small budget. Yeah, so we also have these traceability issues, especially in the commercial space, so you want to know which functions of a device are supposed to work at all. For instance, PostMarket OS supports some devices partially, but I don't know, you can't send SMS on a device, or mobile networking is not working, but Wi-Fi is, and so on. You want to know if you're interested in a special device and in certain functions, you want to know when it was tested for the last time before you get that device. Of course, with what result? Did it pass? Did it fail? how did the test setup look like? So what was tested actually? Yeah, if I have to pair my phone with some headset, then of course I want to know with which headset it was tested. I want to know how this was done exactly, and probably I also want to know by whom this was done, in case I have some questions that I can contact this person. And yeah, typically if you want to find information about that, well, you can go and look in the mailing lists. Can be pretty frustrating. I made this experience, for instance, with Coreboot, where information is distributed in many sources, and sometimes you have to search through archives of mailing lists and so on to find actually information what things work on which board. You can use forums, chats, social media channels, and so on, but you have to do some research to get information about the supported status before buying it. Some other projects try to concentrate this information in wikis or other documents. For instance, PostmarketOS, they have a nice matrix in the wiki. That's not the latest state, but you see here the devices, some code name and so on, and you see the certain functions, and you see if it was tested successfully. It's a definition of a term. A successful test is one that yields an error. So, well, it was tested and it passed the tests, okay? And here it was only partially working or not supported. Nah? And now the interesting aspect is how can you really manage all that information, and maybe how can you find people to contribute to this matrix? How do you manage this whole process? Yeah, and that's actually an issue, I would say. So this brings us to the field of community-supported manual testing. But first of all, manual testing. Yeah, I'm talking really about manual testing. That's not kidding. Yeah, seriously. And if we look at how manual testing is done nowadays, we often find that, well, in the FLOSS world, nobody really wants to do it, especially not the developers, because usually if you do things like, I don't know, does the accelerometer of my device work? Well, I have to shake it, look at the values, okay. Now I want to have 50 devices which I support, so I take out every of the devices, I shake it, it works in the next one. And yeah, it's not very interesting to do that. The situation looks a bit better in the commercial world, where people get some adequate compensation for all the pain and suffering. Yeah, but it's still not very motivating for them. So they do it, they get paid for that, and then they use the money to buy something to compensate for the testing that they had to do. Yeah, and well, the practical issues are, I think, that developers, they love writing code, but they have neither time nor motivation for testing. So I'm asking the developers, raise their hand. So who would agree a bit with that? Yeah, so I was expecting that, yeah. And often the developers, they even don't have access to all these devices that I supported. So if you look at OpenWRT, I want to see the developer who has 1,000 routers on their table to test all of them, yeah. And even then, there is a lack of supporting tools for manual testing. Yeah, so we have some tools in the commercial space which are, I would say, enterprisey. So you have a RUP-style testing process which they think about. You have 20 roles, a test role manager, I don't know, whatever, and they are expecting that you have some testing teams where 200 people are participating in your testing process. But if you're a developer of Gadget Bridge and you have 20 watches which you support, then you probably don't want to have 20 roles in your testing process, right? And in the open source world, there are not many tools to really help with manual testing. So basically, three types of tests, which we also need to differentiate, is I think because when I talk about testing, not everybody thinks about the same thing. So one thing is just a run attempt. That's what many developers think when they do testing. So they are in their development environment. They are writing some code. Ah, yeah, I've written the code. Now let's click on run. They test it. Ah, yeah, that's it. They tested it. No, they didn't really test it because it's not really recorded what they tested, in which state it was, which inputs they made. It's everything lost. The same goes with the, and of course, there is always something special on the developer's machine. Yeah, so they didn't really test the binaries they are releasing, but they tested something inside of the IDE, which is a completely different thing, maybe. And there are, if you take out the binaries, you can do such kind of throwaway tests, right? So you really get a dedicated tester and tell him, okay, do test it. And then the tester gets the system under test, yeah, which is what, I don't know, the application, for instance, and thinks about, oh, yeah, what can we do? Let's click here, let's do that. And until something breaks, and then they open up an issue report. Right, but that's still, it's a kind of testing, but you don't know afterwards what was tested and what was not tested. You only get some information about what was not working, but you're also interested about the scope. I don't know, you had 200 functions which the software offers. Which of them were actually tested? It's quite difficult. So the real testing way is to do really systematic testing, and systematic means it's planned. So before you test, you think about what will I want to test. You write a kind of a test plan of the test steps you want to execute. For each test step, you think about the expected output of the program. And then after you plan that, you go there and you execute the tests. And of course, you make some kind of protocol so you know afterwards what you tested and what you didn't test, and what happened when you tested it. Of course, there is also something about the environment. Maybe there are some preconditions. You have to, I don't know, initiate the database or put some example data in there or whatever before you actually can do testing. And this has to be documented as well. Yeah, so the thing we are trying to propose, I'm calling this community-oriented testing. So the System Test Portal is more or less a platform that tries to provide a common platform for all those different kinds of people. So for test managers who want to know, how is testing going, or can we put out the new release, which tests, which functions were tested, which were not tested. For test designers, so the people who think about new test cases. For the actual testers that execute the tests. For the developers, which are not so interested in testing, but more about what are the bugs that we can fix. And of course, for the end users, that they know, when I get this device, what will work when I install Lineage.js on it, and what will be broken? Yeah, and if you're in the free open source world, you probably have a community, and maybe there are people who love your project. Yeah, there are people who really like OpenScale, and they find it really cool that you provide this app that communicates with the scales. But they are not a developer. They don't know how to use GitHub or whatever. But if you ask them, hey, can you help our project? Yeah, but what can they do? Well, they can actually test. Yeah, I mean, even an average person which would not attend this conference, I think, could stand up on a scale and see if it displays the weight more or less correctly. Yeah, and if it's communicated back to the app and so on. Yeah, so the idea is to provide a platform for all these people to tighten your community also around this aspect of testing. Yeah, and now I'd like to give you a short demo on the System Test Portal before I talk about the project, so you see how it looks like. So first of all, we have to install it. You see I've downloaded here our archive, and we have to unpack it. That was almost the most difficult part. Now we can start the binary. It starts up a server listening on port 8080. And if we open up a web browser, I hope it's not too small. Okay. So we go to localhost 8080, and there we are. So it was pretty hard to install it. I'm also logging in here as administrator. We have like two or three roles, so you can only be a tester that can't change test cases, but only execute them and stuff like that. But I want to be able to do everything. And yeah, here we have two example projects. And let's have a look at Lineage OS. So what you see here is our dashboard. And where's my pointer? So you see, I can also make it a bit bigger maybe. Yeah. So here you can see different test cases. Of course, there is more detail in them. And we can see here a table of the test execution state. So those that have this question mark, we can have a look. That means there was someone who executed the test and observed something, but wasn't sure if it was okay or not. So the test was executed, but the result is unrated, so to say. We have this X here in gray, which means that this test case was not executed. Someone was lazy or the test case is new, I don't know. The green ones are the tests that passed. The red ones are the ones that failed. The yellow ones are so partially successful. So they worked somehow, but maybe something was a bit strange. So yeah, we should look into them. And now we can have a look at some of these test cases, for instance, from the accelerometer. So here we see this one test case, accelerometer. It has some preconditions. If we go to the edit mode, we could add also more preconditions. And here are the test steps, which we also could edit. And each test step basically says, as a tester, what should you do? What inputs should you provide? Or what actions should you do with the system under test? And what do you look for? What should happen? What is the expected outcome? Yeah. So you open the sensors test app. And yeah, the app is open after you do that. It doesn't crash or nothing happens. The app runs, right? And the same with the other things. And then you can later leave comments. We also have a feature for providing an estimate, how long the test cases should run. You can also assign labels to your test cases. If you have a group of testers, you can also assign test cases. So if I have a tester, I can tell him, hey, dude, here's a test case. Please run version 14 on that. I save the assignment. And here we have a list of to-dos or tasks. So the tester then sees, OK, there is something that was assigned to me that I should test. Yeah, and some other stuff like that. We also have a history of test cases. In this example, well, it's just the initial creation, but often, for traceability reasons, you also have to provide some information that when you tested it, how did the test case look like? So you need sort of versioning of your test cases, because if your test case changes, then the procedure you were following when testing the system was different from the procedure you would follow now if you execute the test case today. Yeah, so we can start that to just have a quick run over a test case. So now I'm in the role of a tester. We see the progress bar here. And I have to confirm that the precondition is fulfilled. I have to provide some information about the system under test that I'm on. So I say which version of, here in this case, Lineage OS, am I testing, in which variant. What a variant is depends a lot on how you define it. You can do it in many ways. You can have, I don't know, your device as a variant. We try to keep that as open as possible to leave many possibilities. And you can also execute test cases anonymously, so it will not be visible who executed the test case. Yeah, and now you just go through the steps. You see what you have to do, what you have to look for. And for each step, you can assess it. So let's assume I'm doing that. The app was open. Now the sensors, yes, the sensors are listed. Great. And now all app display sensor data that is not nil. And well, we can say it was partially successful. Why? Because it started displaying after 5 seconds delay. I can also use Markdown here. I can also attach some screenshots or whatever. Yeah, and now after I did all the 3 steps, I'm asked to rate the whole execution of this test case, because we assume that we have a intelligent person in front of the system who is able, that even not if one of them was maybe partially successful, this is able to decide what should the whole test case be rated as, right? So we can say, yeah, well, this was after 5 seconds, but overall, I think it was everything is okay. We can leave it. And now after you've done that, you see here the protocol. In case, for instance, you encountered a bug, you can export it to Markdown. And so you can take all this Markdown text here and paste it in your issue tracker. We also have an export to PDF. Our default template is not very nice, but at least you get a PDF which you can archive, and you can, of course, enhance the template if you want. What we also have here is test sequences. So test sequences is a way to group test cases in a particular order. So for instance, if you have a test case create a new customer, and you have a test case delete customer, you probably first want to create the customer before you delete it, right? So this is your first test case, and this is your second test case. And of course, if one of these fails, it is probably a good decision to skip the rest, right? Maybe not in every case, so you're not forced to do it, but depends on how you design your test sequences. So basically, it's for really grouping things, so you don't execute only small test cases with 4 or 5 steps, but you have a longer chain that, let's say, you assign a tester who has, 30 minutes time to do this, and then the tester can execute the test sequence. We also have this activity view. So, it's like a timeline. You can see what happened in the project, which tests were executed, which tests were edited, and stuff like that. You can also grant some permissions to members. You can look at all previous protocols of previous executions, which you can also filter. You can also look at this at the test sequences or test cases, or filter out failed test cases, for instance. Yeah, and you have some settings like, change the project logo or stuff like that. We've already seen this dashboard. Yeah, unfortunately, there was no manager in the audience, but still I'm showing this. We also have a project, not project-wide dashboard. So it's not only for one project, but for many projects. So assume you have many projects where you are testing. So you want to know, okay, how many test cases do I have? Which of them were how many were successful? How many were partially successful? And so on. So you get some kind of higher level statistics in here. Yeah, and also here we have the tasks. So you can get assigned, for instance, a test case by another user who wants you to run a certain test. And basically, that's it. It was our goal to really keep the application as simple as possible. So people who are thinking about how to better manage the test process, they don't have to learn a new tool for 5 years, but they can just immediately start and use the tool. And I'd like to continue with the presentation, talking a bit more about the tool. So, as you've seen, it's a web application. The basic functions are you can organize test suites and test cases. You can execute test cases. You can analyze the test case executions. We've seen the step-by-step execution, and we have a version variant management. I didn't show that in the demo. It's a bit sophisticated. So if you have a complex system under test, reporting, versioning of test cases. It's GPL v3 licensed, and it's a pure web application. It's mobile friendly. So you don't need any apps or whatever, it just runs in the browser. It's implemented in Go. Very lightweight. I don't know if you've seen that, but I'm running a real ThinkPad with the old IBM logo here. So yeah, it takes about 30 megabytes of RAM to start the system in the configuration we've seen. So it should run even on a much, maybe not on microcontrollers, but on really small boards. It's platform independent. And we also have a CI/CD integration, which was developed as part of our bachelor thesis project. So if you use, for instance, GitLab, which we integrated there as an example, you can do the following. Of course, it doesn't make sense if you have a very agile team that's producing, I don't know, 5 releases every day or 20, to undergo manual testing for each of these, right? But if you do a huge release of a new major version every 3 or 4 months, maybe you don't want to release that before some normal human looked at your tests, right? So what you can do is you can make a pipeline for this release. For instance, you do all the CI stuff, but before you do the CD stuff, you put in our task, and then the CI/CD pipeline will wait until, and we're working with some hooks in this case, so it will wait until all the test cases for this version which you're trying to deploy in System Test Portal have been signed off by or executed and logged by a tester so that these tests are complete. And then you go ahead and deploy the stuff. Yeah, so I've showed that. And I'd now like to continue to talk a bit about the project itself. So yeah, it was a student project, or two student projects at the University of Stuttgart. And we had a total of 17 students. I think we had 6 or 7 students in the first iteration and the remaining ones in the second iteration. Each iteration was about 300 hours of hard work. Maybe it didn't look like that in the demo, but believe me, we've put a lot of work in, because we built it basically from scratch. In the beginning, we thought about reusing something, building it up on Gitty or something, but we decided to do it from scratch. And it was quite a lot of work. It took 18 months. We had a change in the regulations. So the first project was 12 months, the second one was 6 months, but both projects had to do the same amount of work. So there was a high workload, especially in the second iteration. Yeah, well, the system itself is done more or less, and it can be, I would say it can be used in production. There are some minor bugs that are still open. I must confess that we didn't eat our own dog food in every case. So for instance, we built a Windows binary that doesn't run. It's bad, of course, but yeah, we didn't test it ourselves. Maybe we should have. We also, of course, have our own test plan for testing System Test Portal itself, but I think it was late in the project, we didn't execute it, and yeah, stuff happens. The documentation also is still work in progress. We have a Sphinx-based RST-style documentation, but it's not great yet, but we're working on improving it. After these two iterations with the student projects, the project now is continued as a community open source project. And we have quite many ideas for new features. The development has stalled a bit down around, I don't know, February or March. But I have some stuff in the pipeline for continuing that. And I think that we will roll on here and continue that, and especially for those minor bugs that we still have, provide some fixes in the near future. Yeah, so if you want to contribute, if you have additional ideas or whatever, we have the project on GitLab. You're welcome. We love patches from the community, of course. And as you can see, we also have this test case with the binary that is here. I don't know, release blocker, customer priority, extreme label, and stuff like that. Yeah, so basically that was it. So to wrap up, quick summary. So yeah, test automation is great, but it has some limitations. our idea is to provide a platform for the whole community of a project that can glue it together more closely with testing. So even non-developers can help projects by providing test cases, executing test cases, and increase the quality of releases projects put out. And yeah, I've shown the system test portal, which is the tool that we developed to support this goal. Yeah, that's basically it. And now I'm open for questions, comments, or if you want to see something more in the demo. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, and I was advised to go around with the microphone. But where is it? Ah, okay. Yeah. So, questions or comments? Anybody? You're too tired. It's the end of the conference, I know. Ah, there is one.
What was the reason to take Go as a language?
Sorry, the reason to take?
Go, Lang as a language.
Ah, okay. There were a couple of reasons. One of them was, of course, we were curious how to work with Go. And we wanted to have a quite lightweight application. The interesting thing is that at our institute, we usually used to program everything in Java and do most student projects in Java. And we have a sort of competition for students. So we have these study projects where people apply for a project, and there are many projects offered, and there are many students, and sometimes not all projects happen. So there is a competition between the projects, and some of our competitors were even a bit surprised that we do this in Go. Especially after they saw that we got so many applicants for that. So it seems to be pretty fancy. Yeah, but in the end, we got, of course, mixed experience with actually programming in Go. It has pros and cons. I think there was some quite interesting talk here yesterday about using Golang. Especially the state of libraries and so on is, of course, an issue. And also, personally, I'm not a big fan of huge statically compiled binaries. That's another thing. I think you can also make it dynamic in Go, but yeah, we more or less wanted to try something new, and that's why we went for that. Yeah, I think there was another one.
First of all, a very nice project. I'm actually thinking about trying it out. And I have a question, for example, you showed the test cases and mm-hmm. the preconditions. Is it possible to do some more custom fields or something in this process? So how customizable is the input?
Yeah, well, you can, if you edit a test case, I can go back here. So we can go here to the edit view. So you can, of course, add preconditions, but you mean something like changing the structure, right?
For example, give my test designer a list of devices he can choose from, or a list of statuses or something.
Yeah, you can sort of do that by these variants. So we have this kind of version variant management. The dialog is not the best one, that's why I'm usually not showing it, but here you can edit your variants and versions, and then when the tester starts the test case, he or she can select this version or variant. But basically, it's a classic database application, so use a SQLite 3 database with a more or less static structure, so it's not that dynamic how much you can add. But what you can do is adding labels, for instance. And grouping your test cases by them, and then sorting by only specific labels. And of course, you can assign these test cases to your testers. So you, as a test manager, you pick only the relevant test cases for the next release or from the functions that you recently changed, and assign this to your testing forks.
Okay. Thank you.
So, more questions, comments? No? Okay, so thank you, and I welcome any feedback, of course, if you try it. We had a stand at FOSDEM this year. A lot of people dropped by, and we didn't get much feedback back. So please, if you try the system, here is also my personal contact data. Let me know, let our project know how you liked it, what worked for you, what didn't work for you. We really appreciate any feedback on that. Yeah. Thanks.